This is my 34 five-window coupe that I've built over the last 5 years. It's a tribute car to the Mooneyham & Sharp 554 coupe. In 1955, this car first appeared, and it was owned by Gene Mooneyham and Carl Johnson, and they were the original owners of the car, and it started off with fenders on the car at that time. The car evolved over a number of years. Around 1959, the car was silver, was Mooneyham and Sharp. Yeah, the car was a metal flake blue color in early 1960. Evolved from there through a number of stages till about 1963 when the car was sold. Bought by a fellow called Freeman. He ran the car till he sold it to some people in Haverton, Illinois. The car was then painted yellow after that, and they ran it till about 1965, and then after that it disappeared till the 1980s when it reappeared. In 1984, they started the nostalgia drag racing in California, and it was making a big comeback at that time. This car was brought back to California in the mid-80s, and in 1985, when I learned about it coming to Fremont Drag Strip in the Baylands area, I wanted to go down and see the car because I always liked the car as it was one of my favorites. So that's what drew me to it, for wanting to eventually make this car someday. Last few years, I just decided that I wanted to recreate the car and run it on the nostalgia circuit. And the twist on the car is that it looks like the original car did in the early 60s, and it can function as a modern car with modern safety standards and run like a modern car can, but it will look like the original car. Originally, I started off with a four-door body. I had it in my mind that I could make a coupe out of that body because the door length on a four-door is the same as a coupe body. I cut the car up all into little pieces, and what I needed to acquire was quarter panels and a deck lid, and then reshape the back part of the body. So over the course of 5 months, starting in October 2006 to March of 2007, I built the body over that winter. And it evolved from little shreds and shards of body parts, and then eventually came to be a body. I didn't cut up an original car to make a race car out of it. I started from shards of an old car and turned it into what it is. But I have another five-window coupe, which I was able to use as a model for the car and make it exactly like a five-window coupe would look. Found an original frame, and I used the rails of the original frame, and then from there it evolved into a full modern roll cage. And the roll cage that I needed to construct was what they call a 25-1E chassis, and that particular chassis is built to the same specifications as a modern pro stock car, and it's certified to 6 seconds. Okay, the motor is a 1957 392 block. That's the only thing that's original on the motor as far as vintage. It has a modern Bryant crankshaft in it. It's a billet steel crank. It's got Webster billet cylinder heads on it. The motor is running on alcohol, but it's made to run so that I can put many runs on the car without constant maintenance. And that's the whole point of this project, is to be able to run the car without killing it and having it so that it can live. The transmission is a Bruno Lenco, and what that is, it's a converter with a Bruno drive. The Bruno is the portion that holds the torque converter. The Lenco part is behind the Bruno, and it's a three-speed Lenco setup. That gets let go and the car leaves. The transmission is air shifted with a automatic air control shifter. The shifting mechanism is operated by a sensory that picks up engine RPM, and that's when the shifting times occur. We're just going to go through some of the functions that make this car operate. When I turn this switch on to my left, that starts all the electrics working. And the motor is ready to fire. This switch here is for the mag on. when the car has to go through its gears, there's this control up here, which is called the switch actuator, and that's for the transmission. So that means right now the transmission is engaged to function. The transmission can shift by RPM at whatever RPM I set. Or if we're running it in the pits, we need to manually override the shifter. We can automatically shift the transmission by this button here on the handle. As I push that button, that's in second gear. Another click makes it third gear. Now it's in high gear. If I want to throw it back into neutral, or not neutral, sorry, first gear, push that button, it exhausts all the air in the shifter, putting it back into low gear again. When the car launches here, this is the trans brake here. This trans brake gets pushed down here, transmission's in lock, person's foot goes to the pedal here, RPM comes up, and when the car launches, as the lights come down, that gets let go and the car leaves. The transmission is capable of taking 3,000 horsepower, which in my situation will never happen, but the idea there is twice as strong as it needs to be, which I'm pretty happy about because I don't need to concentrate on repairing components as they break. These components won't break under my situation. The differential is a 57 American Pontiac housing that I decided to disguise in the fact that I've got Ford 9-inch internal components in it with 40 spline axles and all the modern heavy-duty components, and it's got a Mark Williams center section with 457 gears in it. Another part of modern technology is shock absorbers. These particular shock absorbers in the car are electronic shocks. The bump and the compression of the shocks are controlled electronically by pneumatic controls and electric motors in the tops of the shocks. We're just going to go through a couple of things here that enable the shocks to function. And there's a group of items here. There's a bottle in the back here. That's a CO2 bottle, and that allows pressure to enter the sweeps at the bottom of the shock absorbers, which are down here. Those operate the bottom controls, which are the bump adjustments. These controls down here are little pneumatic actuators, which they're called sweeps, and they're controlled by the timers that let in the CO2 gas to make them go through their action as the timers trip. As the system is engaged, there's a group of timers over here, and these timers have got little switches on them which can be set so that as the car goes down the racetrack, it can go through a series of times that enable the shocks to function correctly. The bottle over here is the CO2 gas, and it has a regulator on it, and the higher pressure on the regulator allows gas to enter the transmission and the shifter and operates it. The lower pressure here gets split by this regulator here and goes to the timers, and this operates the shock absorbers.
It's a system that was developed in Formula One racing originally, but it's eventually evolved into drag racing, and the pro stock cars and the higher end comp cars have been using this system. So I decided to try and incorporate that system into the car to make it more safe and function better as it goes down the racetrack. The class that I'm going to be running this car in is called Nostalgia One Eliminator, and it's part of NHRA's Heritage Series, which they run a number of races throughout the West Coast. A couple of the races that I intend on going to regularly is the March meet at Bakersfield and the Hot Rod Reunion in October, typically. And that group of races, they have a number of categories that accommodate all the nostalgia type cars. This one is going to be running in NE1, which the index for that class is 760. The 760 means that you can't go any faster than 760. If you do, you break out. But you have to get there before the other guy does in order to win the race. My business here consists of custom work, mostly related to hot rods and race cars. I do a lot of job work too for anybody, whether they're in the movie business, people that need components fabricated or manufactured. I can do small runs of things. I specialize in aluminum and stainless steel welding. Do all kinds of special things that the average person might not be able to do. Because I've built all these cars myself, I've kind of honed these talents that that allow me to do these things. And so in one way, it's been able to make my hobby my business at the same time, and it all seems to work together. At this point in time, we're about a week and a half to 2 weeks to a fire up on the car. There's a few little details that I have to attend to, and we're just getting through that. I'm trying to run a business and do that all at the same time. So these last details have been things I've been working on either early in the morning or late at night when I come back here and everything's quiet. The car should work pretty good. All the motors that I start up here, they usually start unless I have a glitch, which sometimes can happen, but so far everything looks good. There's been components tested in the car. The electric components have had their checks done on them. The motor's got oil pressure. There's no leaks. There's no oil on the ground. These are all good things.
Yeah, it went really smooth. We had a little hiccup in the beginning with a sucked gasket in under the throttle body there, and but that was it. Considering a car that this is its first time after all the years of building it, that for its first warm up, it went really smooth. And I think Luke mentioned earlier that we're really fortunate to have a fellow on board from Australia that helped us with a tune up, and it's just right on the money. So that kind of makes my job easy.
I'd like to thank Ken Lowe for setting up our fuel system, which is just incredible. Pretty well right from the get-go with his input. This thing is right on the money. Like when I hit that throttle, it's there. Like it's not going to need much.
Yeah. It was in reverse.
Yeah.
Well, I was really fortunate. I was born and raised in North Vancouver, and Luke's been in North Vancouver as long as I can remember. And so we were both in the trade, hot rod trade and automotive trade. So we got to know each other over the years. And I was very fortunate that when he started this program, he asked me if I would come and give him a hand with it, as I've got some expertise particular to tuning up blown alcohol stuff, and I build racing engines for a living as well. So it sort of was a good fit, and we know each other, and everything's good. So that was it. He just asked me if I'd give him a hand, and here I am, and loving it. It's an awesome piece.
This is our home away from home when we're at the racetrack and on the road. This trailer was empty when I got it, and all the little fixtures and tire mounts and fuel jug holders here. This is all handmade stuff, things that I make here at the shop, all aluminum fabrication.
In case we need them.
I mean, in the case of Luke, he's an artisan, he's a craftsman, so every single part of the car, almost, he's handmade. You can buy a lot of the stuff for these cars, but he's an expert machinist, and so whatever we need, he just makes the part for the car. So, but to do stuff like that is, I mean, every little bracket, you know, might be 8 or 10 hours just for one bracket. There's hundreds of them on the car, and that's just brackets. You know, the welding and the tin work and fabrication involved, and the machining time, and then just trying to access parts for stuff like this is really difficult. Sometimes in Canada, it's a little more to get stuff than if we were in America, as per se. So, it's a huge effort. It takes years.
So I'm the show director of the new event coming to Vancouver. It's called the Vancouver Collector Car Show, Sale, and Auction, taking place at the PNE Fairgrounds, June 22 and 23. We have 12 acres of space. We plan on having about 600 cars on site, all capped off by a 120 car auction. It's the PNE on steroids for people that like old cars. I came out to talk to Luke about showing his car and having some fun with us. We're obviously looking for a range. This show is a lot about hot rods, drags, classic cars, vintage cars. So we're really all over the place, and we really want to be everything we can be to the hobby. And when there's amazing builds like this that are going on right in our backyard and a stone's throw away from the PNE, you know, we'd be remiss not to come out and check them out and see if we can have some fun and show it to a good 20 to 30,000 people. All make and model, you know, we have everything from Italian to British. The heavy reliance is North American and classic muscle, and that's what you're seeing a lot of in the auction as well. So I think I'm around 10 vets in the auction right now, all different C classes. So we're all over the place. It's going to be fantastic and a lot of fun. We have Steve Mignante coming up, and just a fantastic event shaping up.